Welcome to the American Heart Association Statements and Guidelines Podcast, where we'll discuss clinical practice guidelines and scientific statements on various cardiovascular disease and stroke topics.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Brian Hoh, and I'm a neurosurgeon, and I'm the chair of neurosurgery at the University of Florida.
And my name is Narissa Koh. I'm a neurointensivist and vascular neurologist at UCSF Medical Center in San Francisco.
This is our final episode discussing the American Heart Association and American Stroke Association's updated guidelines for treating patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. In this episode, we are dealing in detail with some of the most important complications that can arise. And this is an area where nurses play a huge role. So for this episode, we wanted to welcome a third host, Kiffon Keigher.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Hoh and Dr. Koh. Super excited to be here as part of this author group. Just a quick introduction myself. I am a doctorate prepared acute care nurse practitioner. I have about 20 years of neuroscience and stroke background experience and really started in the neurocritical care environment. So I am really honored to have worked as part of this author group and to be able to share my knowledge into the guidelines and to have be here as a representative on nursing practice. Really, nurses are, as you all know, that first line clinician, oftentimes at seeing these really acute care patients that are coming into our hospitals with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages. And so having expert nurses at the bedside who are certified, that understand our guidelines, that can really come to the bedside with expertise and knowledge around how to take care of these patients is critically important. So really excited that the new guidelines are really establishing what that workflow and best practice should look like for nurses. And I think we've done a really nice job in this new guideline in helping to establish what that upfront care needs to look like for nurses and really moving through the continuum through their post-acute recovery and into the ambulatory space of what's needed for follow-up for aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages. I would remind everybody that when it really comes down to the acute setting, you know, some of the things that we really discussed and stressed within the guidelines is the importance of the neurological assessments for patients in those initial hours and days. We know our patients have long stays with us, oftentimes in a course like aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, and really having that frequent neurological assessment using GCS and NIH scales is critically important. So we have validated tools used to assess our patients on a frequent basis. Coming hand in hand with that, I would say we really identified the frequency of vital sign monitoring. And while we don't establish a set parameter around that, we do know that the literature supports that frequent vital sign and neuroassessment is important, and really for the nurse to understand when to escalate that, when parameters are not within what we've set out or what is expected, and how to escalate that back to the provider so that we can potentially go to next steps and provide some interventions. I would also point out that one of the things that we discussed was the importance of dysphagia screening to prevent aspiration pneumonias. And then another thing that we really stressed in this guideline was around mobilization and what's important about mobility for our patients. When is the right time? We often think that we want to mobilize our patients early. And while that is true, we want to be able to do that safely and making sure that it's impacting their, you know, recovery and moving them into that rehabilitative state.
Thank you, Kiffon. You highlight some extremely important issues that nursing is really in partnership with all care providers in the care of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. We're going to focus on two big complications, and we want to talk about in detail our vasospasm and delayed cerebral ischemia, as well as hydrocephalus. Although these are not the most common, they are often the kinds of complications that cause major setbacks to recovery, so it's essential to catch them as early as possible. About 30% of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhages will develop a delayed cerebral ischemia, and it's most likely to come on after the patient's through their early injury, about day 4 to 14 after the initial hemorrhage.
Yeah, that's very true. I appreciate you bringing that up. We did have a lot of discussions around vasospasm and DCI. And this is a really critical time for nursing assessment. I would argue that probably that neurological assessment, it really always kind of comes back to that, is having a strong nursing assessment, understanding what your patient's deficits are, or if they're at that kind of stable and expected point of where you expect to see their assessment, or are you seeing changes? Many times are often subtle in this vasospasm and DCI period. You know, we do have diagnostic tools that we expect nurses to understand and to know about, including things like transcranial Dopplers. This is something we expect our patients to be receiving on a regular basis throughout that early course of their stay with us. We also expect our patients to have advanced imaging when warranted, things like CT angiography or CT perfusion studies. It's important for nurses to know to be proactive about talking about changes in exam, understanding they may need to get their patients ready for advanced imaging or TCDs every day. And certainly when it comes to advanced imaging and contrast-related studies, important to understand, how does that affect their renal function? Are we monitoring that? What does their dye loads look like, or any allergies that they may have? So those are really important things for nurses to keep in their pocket as part of their regular assessment. I would also say that some centers are fortunate enough to have cerebral microdialysis and other advanced diagnostic tools. And these are, again, important, that some of these can be extremely time-consuming for the nurse at the bedside and really require nurse training and expertise. Our programs need to take that into consideration in how we're going to train and educate our nurses to be able to run these advanced diagnostics for our patients.
One of our most important clinical interventions for patients who are high risk to develop a delayed cerebral ischemia is to use elevated blood pressure and maintain euvolemia, especially if patients are starting to show focal neurological symptoms in the setting of vasospasm. However, it's important to know that prophylactic hemodynamic augmentation, or raising the blood pressure preventatively, has been shown to cause harm.
I would also go on to say that it is important to remember that we're going to start on day one nimodipine for our patients. And this is something that we expect each of our patients to be receiving on a daily basis. Typically, we're starting this right on day one. That's the expectation. Of course, some patients may have contraindications, which will be discussed, we hope, on rounds and with the multidisciplinary team. But nimodipine is a calcium channel blocker that we are administering to our patients during that vasospasm DCI period. We expect to be given up to day 21 post-subarachnoid hemorrhage. So important that the nurses understand the indication for something like nimodipine, how long we give it, why we're giving it, monitoring blood pressure, and the importance of making sure we make sure we don't have exam changes as our patients' blood pressures may become lower and drop and have hypotension, and that that's not altering their exams in any ways.
So in addition to DCI and vasospasm, another major concern we need to have is hydrocephalus. Acute hydrocephalus occurs in 15 to 87% of patients. And if it occurs, we have a class 1 recommendation for urgent cerebral spinal fluid diversion with either an external ventricular drain, EVD, or lumbar drain. The important thing there is we have a class 1 recommendation when you're placing an EVD, that you have a bundled EVD protocol. And for patients that have chronic hydrocephalus, then there's a class 1 recommendation that permanent cerebral spinal fluid diversion is performed.
Yeah, this is a really important topic for nurses, as much of the work around setting up the EVDs, implementation and initiation of an EVD, And monitoring and management of the EVD really falls on the nurse at the bedside with these patients. So I would say that that was something that really we did identify as an opportunity and a knowledge gap. As our author group spoke about the literature and the research around EVD's management, monitoring, insertion, weaning protocols, there was there's a lot of variability and really coming to a consensus in designing one best practice. What we did, however, find is that there is a class one recommendation, and we did design a class one recommendation for the initiation of an infection protocol for patients with an EVD in place. I think that's really important that our providers and our nurses at the bedside remember to initiate this protocol. In terms of other nursing assessment, it is important to understand other management properties around the drain. What type of dressing is being used? What is the frequency of the dressing changes? What is your weaning protocol? Your weaning protocol going to look like? Do you clamp and drain? Or are you allowing continuous clamping? So really working with your teams and having a standard protocol is important around weaning. What does EVD flushing look like? Who's the one in charge of doing that? Who's privileged to do it? So really establishing standard protocols around some of these frequent interventions having to do with drains is an important piece for nurses at the bedside to be educated on, to be trained on, and really to have it a competency around on a regular basis.
So as you can tell, it's been a long road to manage aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage patients, along with many complications in both the early brain injury phase as well as the secondary brain injury phase. All through this process, it's important to have good communication and robust monitoring for these complications and working with a multidisciplinary team. And that is one of our class one strongest recommendations, that early multidisciplinary team approach extends into planning for the rehabilitation and final outcome for these patients. By early acknowledgement of our rehabilitation needs for the patient, we can reduce our lengths of stay and identify what the patient and their families are going to need to have a safe and successful discharge. We want to be thinking about that even in the throes of managing the ICU complications, to always have that line of communication open with all of our team members as well as the family. It includes, you know, sometimes a palliative care consult, a social work consult, sometimes really allaying the family's concern about finances. It's really important to keep this dialogue of the entire team as part of the process of moving towards rehab and recovery.
And so it's really essential to continue screening and evaluating our patients in a number of dimensions as we get them ready for that rehab stage and thinking about discharge to home. It is a class one recommendation that we should be screening for physical, cognitive, and behavioral health issues for that patient, and really how those potential issues might impact their quality of life. It is unfortunate that many of our patients will have some deficits in these areas, but really critical that we identify these as early as possible in their hospital course, certainly prior to them being discharged and moving on to that next phase of care as they progress through their recovery. There are a number of different scales we can use. We have our subarachnoid hemorrhage interventional trialist and our four scores, which help to identify and indicate mortality and three-month functional outcome. We have our fresh scores, which help us to identify and indicate quality of life. And then we have our MoCA cognitive assessment tools, which really help us to identify where is our patient's baseline using a validated tool such as MoCA and any kind of cognitive deficits that they may have as they transition out of the hospital to try and get back home into a baseline that they were at prior to their hospital course.
We know that depression and anxiety is really common in patients that have just gone through such a traumatic event. And we really believe that screening for these things and addressing them is the best way to get people better. So we don't just want to monitor their physical condition, but also their state of mind.
Absolutely. And as a nurse, we spend a lot of time with our patients at the bedside. And in addition to our patients, we spend a lot of times with their family members, their loved ones, their closest friends, their caregivers. And we always want those closest to them to be keeping an eye out for depression and anxiety. And really, this is a strong class one recommendation that we came up with in the guideline is to screen for depression and anxiety. Some tools that we can use for this screening is we have our GAD-7 and our hospital anxiety depression scale. We have our BDI screening for anxiety. We have our PHQ-2, and our PHQ-9 screening for depression. We always want to be looking for changes in our patient's affect. Do we note these changes? I think we always want to make sure we're asking our family members and our the caregivers of our patient, do you notice any changes? Has there ever been a time that you've seen so-and-so depressed? Are there strategies around helping them through this depression and to get back to something that might help them that you've noted in the past? So for patients with depression, we do have a class one recommendation to use psychotherapy and a pharmacology type treatment and intervention. But I do think it's important to know that in patients without depression, we have a recommendation against using fluoxetine, which is a new recommendation coming out of this guideline that we want our nurses and providers to be aware of.
I think you highlight really well the importance of communication with families all through the process, as this is not just an illness that affects the patient, but all of their caregivers, loved ones, and families. And throughout this guideline, we've emphasized the importance of shared decision-making, really answering questions and making sure that patients and families understand the process along the way. And it's critical to have these honest conversations to make sure that we're achieving the best outcomes customized for each individual patient. So last but not least, one really important part of the recovery process is continued imaging and follow-up to monitor the plan of treatment for any aneurysm remnants, any recurrence, or regrowth of the treated aneurysm. We recommended a short-term and long-term imaging to make sure everything is still looking good for these patients who've already survived a very difficult aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage course. Although there's no specific timing, it's important to make sure these patients are followed up beyond their hospital stay.
And then in the long term, we want the patient to do routine supravascular imaging to detect either recurrence or regrowth of the treated aneurysm, changes in another known aneurysm, or development of a new de novo aneurysm. Regular imaging checkups is especially important for younger patients with multiple aneurysms or those that have a strong family history of it, one or two first-degree relatives with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. This kind of preemptive imaging can guide treatment decisions and reduce the risk of future aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage in survivors. I think we all know of examples. I certainly have had patients that have had a ruptured aneurysm who we later find on follow-up imaging to have recurrence of their treated ruptured aneurysm.
So that's the end of this podcast series highlighting some of the most important elements of these updated guidelines. For more detailed information about them and the visual aids, please visit the professional.heart.org website.
We think that these guidelines give you all the information you need to develop order sets and a game plan for how to treat patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. It's not an easy situation to deal with, but if you understand the risk, complications, and best treatments, and work together with a multidisciplinary team with expertise, you can give patients the best chance and you can save lives.
The data and statistics presented in this podcast are from the official guideline being released by the American Heart Association. Any and all personal stories and testimonies are that of the talent, host, and volunteers and are not reflective of any statements or position of the American Heart Association. For a full manuscript of the guideline released, please visit the official American Heart Association website at professional.heart.org.